I'm gonna get you a gavel.
There you go.
Well, I'll just.
It is 6 o'clock. Call this meeting to order. The first item on our agenda is nomination for appointment. Inez McBride, precinct one. I will need a motion to, I'm sorry, Inez is here. Inez, do you want to step forward and tell us just a little bit about yourself, if you would, please?
Okay, well, I've been a resident here forever, almost, and currently practice law in San Antonio. I do represent employers in employment law. I've also done early career, some bankruptcy work, general litigation. But mostly now, I emphasize representing employers. I've done some work for some hospitals and doctors, so I'm somewhat familiar with how things run well and when they don't run so well. So eager to help out here as I can.
Thank you very much. That's our nominee to be appointed to the board to fill the vacancy in precinct one. I would need a nomination.
So move.
Okay, in a second.
Okay.
Okay. Been nominated by Ronnie Echo, seconded by Allison Lambert, that we accept the nomination of Inez McBride to fill the vacancy in precinct one. All in favor, raise your hand. All opposed? Okay, thank you. At our next scheduled strategic planning committee meeting, Inez, you will be sworn in as a member of the board at that point. Okay? All right. Next item on the agenda is the roll call. And we start with Tom Miller.
Here.
Ronnie Echo.
Here.
Kay Bagan.
Here.
Allison Lambert.
Here.
David Watson.
Here.
Marcelo Leyas.
Here.
Tom Ray.
Here.
Larry Richardson, here. We're all present. Very good. Thank you. Next item is to approve the December board member minutes. Everybody take a few minutes and just look those over. Are there any corrections, amendments, or additions that we need to make to the minutes?
I move we approve the December board meeting minutes as presented.
Okay. Do I hear a second?
I'll second.
Who is that? Been moved by Ronnie Echo, seconded by David Watson, that we accept the December board minutes as presented. Any questions? All in favor, raise your hand. All opposed? Motion carries. Next item is our citizens' input. We have one person signed up to speak, and that is Carter Thomas. Mr. Thomas?
I'm going to pause. I'm going to pass. I signed up to specifically save a spot to ask a question about elections when they come up, if necessary. Is that possible?
I think our discussion about the election might answer your questions.
That's what I'm saying. But if it's unclear, if I could ask a question at that point, that's all I want to know.
The chair would accept one question about the election. Okay.
Maybe a run-on question, maybe.
Well, we've got a lot of business to conduct, and we don't want to have a discussion off the board agenda. Rather. Okay, our next item is CEO report. Brian?
Good evening, everybody. Hope you all are doing well. Glad that we're going to have a good conversation this evening. My topics are also fairly brief for the evening, just a handful of updates. First, I want to share with you some exciting news that I think many of you are already aware of. We got a tremendous honor not too terribly long ago, towards the end of December, from the American Heart Association, American Stroke Association. As you know, we've done a lot of work with our stroke protocols here at the hospital, advancing our telestroke robot, and honoring the stroke associations Get With The Guidelines program. What they have recognized us for is our commitment to being on par, so to speak, or even significantly better than par related to how we perform stroke care. And they've recognized us with the Silver Plus Award for two consecutive years related to our stroke care. But the letter that they wanted to share with us is that they were presenting a presentation in the 2017 edition of the U.S. News and World Report annual related to best hospitals. Every year they put this this out, and wanted to comment that now the screen has gone black. I can see it in the, in the mirror. So let's get that back up there. Anyway, what the American Stroke Association, Heart Association, just wanted to congratulate Conley for their work again in stroke, and wanted to let us know that they were going to be recognizing us in the 2017 edition of U.S. News and World Report's Best Hospital Edition. That's a big deal, guys. I mean, it really is. You know, not all hospitals get listed in this publication. It comes out every year. So just wanted to make sure that we shared that as a good news with you all.
Can I ask a question?
Sure.
So I hate to put you on the spot, but there are some new board members here. Can you just give us a brief overview about our stroke protocols and what happens if you come in here with showing something?
I would be happy to. So if you come to our emergency room and you have stroke-like symptoms, first thing we're going to do is push you into the triage or put into a bay. We're going to start a series of questions targeted towards stroke. There's a lot of things that one should identify that we're going to rule stroke in or we're going to rule stroke out that happen very quickly. It's paged overhead. You're taken to a CT scan of the head to see if we have a bleed going on or some ischemic stroke. So a lot of things are going on very quickly. So at that time, it showed that there's a bleed. You go down one path. If it's not a bleed, meaning the clot buster might be appropriate to for the patient to receive. And then we go down that. I can personally say that in, gosh, it's already almost to the day, that 2 years ago my brother had a stroke, and he came here, and he was exhibiting. He was bad. And so we quickly put him into room one where our stroke robot is. We had a neurologist on the line in about 15 minutes, and talking with my sister-in-law, talking with us, talking with the doctor, talking with the nurses on a plan of care for him. He quickly got the clot buster. Almost instantaneously, we saw relief. And I'm proud to say that today he has no deficits. We got him to San Antonio. So it's a great program. It's great for our community. It worked for him. It's worked for many others. So it's a huge plus for Wilson County. I can definitely say that. So it's been ongoing. It took over a year to get it up and running. We partnered with Methodist, and the fruits of that labor is just—it's very significant.
How many people benefit from our stroke protocols per year?
Oh, well, I can tell you that for the last 5 years, it's gone just from a very small number to, gosh, I got the report just the other day. Over 100. We see over 100 stroke patients in 2016, and that's, we gave TPA, I believe, six times during 2016, which is the clot buster. And so not every patient's appropriate. There's a lot of guidelines. You have to be within 6 hours of your last known well time for it to be effective. So there's a lot of you have to, you know, criteria that you have to be met. Not everybody qualifies for that. So it's been very, very, very beneficial for the county.
So I wanted to share that news with everybody. This was our first opportunity to give it to you officially, and you'll be proud that your organization will be noted in U.S. News and World Report's 2017 Best Hospitals Edition. Great job, Sue and the team. Another quick item here, just to cover. This is under the category of recent events. Also, since our last board meeting, we have done the ribbon cutting of our two pediatric rooms. You know that this board, as well as our friends in Consolata, have supported the idea of advancing pediatric care throughout our community. Dr. Charlie Moorhead obviously has joined our team as a pediatrician. She's extremely busy at the North Campus, providing care to kiddos. And of course, we have gone through the process of renovating two rooms upstairs in order to make sure they are available and suitable for taking care of pediatric patients. We had a great ribbon cutting there. Here's a little video that put together on it. Not sure if it's coming across or not. It's not coming across. Looks like we're having all kinds of technical problems this morning. But it is, we just wanted to make sure that everyone was able to know that we had over 50 people who attended that, great attendance that day. And really, everyone in the community who was there spoke really highly of the rooms, the comfort that it will provide both patients and visitors and their families, but also the advancement that Conley was making in terms of making sure that we had pediatric care available here locally. So just wanted to share elements of that ribbon cutting ceremony with you. If you can't see it here, you can certainly see it on our Facebook page. It was recently posted, so it's a great video, Sam. It really is. And gives a little bit of attention to just how much fun was had that day with the ribbon cutting process. Another just quick update there. Last month, the board did approve a MRI purchase. That was an item that we definitely heard from the community was something that they wanted to see the hospital invest in. Bob and Woody have done a great job in finalizing that negotiation and getting us on the timeline to get this complete. So I just wanted to give you a quick update that this was underway. Over the last several weeks, we've completed the planning and the initial paperwork. January 29th, the implementation team will be on site to do the kickoff. A little bit later in April, the construction will be complete, and then 15 to 30 days after the installation will be complete. So just wanted to inform you what we didn't know specifically in December, what the timeline of this would be. Here is the official timeline of this project. Just want to let you know that was underway. The next item on the agenda is just something very general. I know we'll probably have a little more, actually probably a lot more detailed discussion about this in future meetings. But what I wanted to do was to illustrate to our board and our community, again, the complexity, the significance, and the impact that our clinic system has had. A lot of times we talk about the clinic system in terms of financials, or we talk about it in terms of patients, but what I really wanted to share with you just in two particular slides is a re-primer of who our clinic system is. We'll go into a lot more detail on these items in a future meeting, but you know, the decision that this board made in 2012 to start the clinic system and improve access to care all across the county was a big one. We went from being just Floresville's hospital to being the largest healthcare provider across the county. You can see, of course, that the map I use all the time illustrates that we're not just here in Floresville anymore. We have locations in Poth and Stockdale, in Lavernia, and at 775 and 181, trying again to make sure that we're serving the entire community with a systematic and coordinated effort of patient care. But I think what's interesting is that the clinic system has also grown from, you know, just two physicians, Dr. Peterson and then Dr. Nyack, back in 2012, to have 18 providers working within our team. 18 providers, that's physicians and nurse practitioners and physician's assistants, but 18 healthcare professionals, clinicians associated with our organization providing care across Wilson County. Glad to see Dr. Profeta here, Dr. Eckmark, Dr. Peterson, both in family practice, Dr. Nyack in cardiology, Dr. Faulkner, ENT, Dr. Krause, orthopedics, Dr. Hassan, GI, Dr. Charlie Moorhead, pediatrician, great addition, Dr. Preston Moorhead, general surgeon, great addition, Dr. Kella, urology. Those services were not available here previously, and again, this board's work and the team's work to develop this clinic system has been very, very significant. Over the last year or two, we've also added a number of nurse practitioners and mid-level providers. Liz Clancy serves the Poth area. Becky Roars worked with Dr. Eckmark. Pam Clark works with Dr. Peterson. Kirsten Furl works with Dr. Peterson and Dr. Hassan. Shauna Kurz works with Dr. Crowley. Christina Hosek sees patients in Stockdale locally. Kathy Breitspecker is a pediatric nurse practitioner with Charlotte Moorhead. And of course, we can't forget to mention Mike Nesbitt, who is the original PA associated with the development of our urgent care clinic. He and other folks practice over at the Laverne Urgent Care Clinic. So what I'm trying to illustrate back to the board for our discussion is that the clinic system is a very, very important part of our operation. Not only is it a very complex portion of the operation, it's also really our number one way to make sure the patients are receiving access through our system. Here are a couple of other just generic thoughts. As you can see how our providers are spread away.
Now, just as a reminder to the board, we also have two additional family practice doctors that are online for this year.
That's correct.
One in March and one in September.
Yes.
Roughly,
yeah.
Correct?
Yes, sir.
Two additional doctors.
Yeah. As a matter of fact, Dr. Eschenroder, he'll be doing his home hunting visit here with his wife, Lauren, the last week of January, January 26th, they'll be making their return visit here to prepare for their arrival later in the year.
Right. These doctors, mid-30s? How old are they?
Yeah, Dr. Henley, I would say, is probably mid-30s. Dr. Eschenroder is probably early 30s. Yeah. Right at the beginning of their 30s. Dr. Henley is an established wonderful, wonderful, wonderful physician, but Dr. Eschenroder will be starting his career with us.
Have we identified their space, like where they're going to be?
Yeah, you know, that's kind of an ongoing conversation, but we do have space here in Floresville. We do have some space in Lavernia, and we're going to be working through that as the year goes on, getting ready for Dr. Eschenroder. That's really where we are.
You know, I've got an interesting story about Dr. Kella. I've got a friend that lives in Kent. Kent is between Balmoray and Van Horn.
It's not the end of the world, but you can see it from there.
That's right. The population of Kent is maybe 10, maybe a little bit more. Somebody sleeping in their car overnight. But he was found to have prostate cancer a couple of years ago. And he had doctor friends from El Paso who he knew to go to consult with. And he said, who should I go to for my prostate cancer? And they told him Dr. Kella. So he goes home and he looks up Dr. Kella. Well, where is Dr. Kella?
Floresville. Yeah.
Yeah. So even the doctors in El Paso knew to send somebody from Kent to Floresville.
He also checked with MD Anderson, and they mentioned Dr. Kelly. So he's well respected in his field. Well respected.
You got it.
Good job.
It's an outstanding team. It's an outstanding team. Here's just some other facts, and again, I know this will play into some other future conversations, but just to give you an idea, I mean, just again, this is kind of a reprimer. Main campus, North Campus, Postdoc Dell, and Avernia, these are the number of providers that we have there. It's not full-time equivalents, of course, but we were able to describe that 10 providers spend time here, 5 at the North Campus, 2 at Pope, 2 at Stockdale, and 5 over at Avernia. So again, making sure that multiple faces, multiple physicians are practicing in each of the areas. The facilities have that level of exam rooms is listed there. Again, 28 here on the main campus, 10 on the North Campus. 2 in Pope, 4 in Stockdale, 6 in Avernia. Also takes a number of employees, obviously, to keep this portion of the enterprise running. You know, we know that providing a good service, getting people in to receive their care, getting back in the exam room, that doesn't happen without the support of great employees. And just really illustrating that there are a lot of employed people working through Conley, through our clinic system, to provide support to the 27 here on the main campus, specific to clinic system, 12 at the North Campus. You can read the slide from there. But I think what is fascinating, again, is the growth of our clinic system from zero patient visits to, you know, on track for 50,000 patient visits. This is about how it breaks out. Over the course of the year, we'll see almost 20,000 people here on the main campus. Another 15,000, obviously a big portion of those will be children at the North Campus. Pope and Stockdale receive a number of patients. It's great to be providing services to that community. And the Avernia Urgent Care and Health Center will also generate about 16,000 visits over the course of the year. So we've often talked about going from zero visits to 48,000, 50,000 visits a year. I wanted to give you a little bit of a impression of how those are divided out, and actually it's all of our communities choosing to seek care with these physicians that we've provided access to. I thought that was a fascinating stat that we just got. Okay. Again, obviously more talk about the clinic system to cover. Two other items just for future discussion. We have operated a call center, and that is an item that has had its pluses and minuses. We brought the call center together out of the need to distribute patient calls and visits effectively. We were really struggling with handling patient calls into the clinics and wanted to try to bring it into a call center situation. As a primer, what I wanted to do here was just share with you a little bit of details about that. The call center is available for primary care providers and pediatrics. That's actually changing, but that runs 8 to 5. 4 employees are there taking about 380 calls a day. So we do talk about the call center, but it is it's a high volume of phone calls. There's a little bit of activity there. That's the average. The high for patient phone calls in one day was 600. So again, a lot of traffic coming through those phone lines. The peak hours are between 8 a.m. and 10 a.m. of every day. And the average call to schedule a patient or provide a prescription, refill connection to the clinic is about 4.5 minutes. We do have a number of patients, probably more than we would like, going to voicemail. That's about 11% of the calls will go into voicemail. Probably that is a high amount for a call center of this type. We would like to see that be lower. I know everyone in this room has heard a little bit about the call center, good and bad. We have made the decision to pull pediatrics out of the call center and have Dr. Charlie's office directly deal with their calls. That decision has been made and has been implemented. Just again, simply because the pediatric care was a little bit more specific than the family practice calls that we were getting. So that item has taken place. Right now, Dr. Peterson, we're contemplating Now that we have the receptionist there taking those calls, we're contemplating having Dr. Peterson align with that arrangement there at the North Campus. But Dr. Eckmark has requested, because he's at multiple facilities and because he works with multiple nurse practitioners, he wants to have a centralized location where he can get his schedule handled very appropriately. So we're still navigating through that, but what I wanted to report to the board was two things. Number one, we have been adjusting our approaches there, trying to make it easier for patients and for physicians. But number two, I wanted to share really some statistics that I thought were relevant to just the scope of calls that were coming through the call center.
So who's taking the calls on the pediatrics? Is that a receptionist or is that a nurse practitioner or?
It'll be the frontline call, you know, to get the appointment scheduled, the receptionist type of person.
So if I'm a parent and I call there and my child is running 102 fever, do I make an appointment or do I get to talk to somebody who can help?
You said that perfectly, Ronnie, and I think that was one of the things that made it important for us to put pediatrics back with Dr. Charlie directly. That person sits right next to Dr. Charlie's office. So the expectation is when we have that type of patient, that there's a question about, how urgently they need to be brought in, the answer is, come on in, we'll get you figured out, and the receptionist can visit with Dr. Charlie to make sure that happens effectively. So you hit the question, the nail right on the head with that question. Okay. My last clinic system overview, just for topic's sake, Ronnie said this perfectly. Even when things are going well, we always want to look for things to improve on. The clinic system is certainly one of those items. We know that we've seen great growth. We know that we've seen very rapid growth. And we know that is always an item that we want to try to stay connected with. Our major challenges or opportunities there are continuing to provide training to our employees. We have a little bit of turnover in the clinic system related to employees, so we want to try to make sure that we're able to keep people well trained. Marketing and volume consistency. Sometimes we have a significantly high week, some days we have weeks that are less busy. So the marketing component of communicating about the strength of our clinic system, that's an ongoing topic. You'll hear a little bit more about that in the upcoming strategic planning and marketing committee. Optimizing our electronic medical record. It's a great communication tool amongst our team, and there's still many, many ways that we can advance the use of our electronic medical record. The docs and the clinic system team are working on that regularly. And of course, we know the complexities of billing collection and just the overall financial performance of the clinic system will always be an ongoing topic for us. So I just wanted to share out, we talk about the clinic system, we talk about our docs, we talk about the strength of our team. I wanted to communicate to the board that no one's resting on our laurels. We want to continue to make it better. And this was kind of a reprimer of where we are, how big we've grown, how complex we've become, and put a little bit of attention to a couple of key items.
A standardized process. I hear comments that every time you go to see a different doctor within our system, you have to fill out name, social security number, Can that be streamlined, or are there liability issues that have to do with that? Since the last time that you filled that out, you may have had surgery, you may have had something to change that. What is the
kind of what Ronnie? I think the short answer is on demographic information. Our people should be saying, has your address changed? Has your insurance company changed? Trying to make that part as streamlined as possible. But I do think if anyone's being asked to fill out a form that has medical history on it or any of those types of items, we are wanting to see if there are any changes that we might not be aware of as part of the process.
Can we do that online? Could I do it from home? I know I'm going in tomorrow and just
Can I access it online and fill it out so that it's?
We do have a patient portal, so patients are able to go in and check their medical records. What I don't know, just off the top of my head, is how interactive that can be for patients to fill out and change information. So I do know that we have a patient portal that allows folks to see Elvis' medical record. But I mean, you're bringing up a great point. If I can register on Southwest using the kiosk, you would think that type of thing would be available in healthcare over time. Those were my main updates. The last topic here is EMS updates. Just continues to be an active project for us. We know that we're obviously navigating an opportunity to educate our community about this and the strength of our plan and our goals that we have. But outside of that effort, there's still some practical work that we're working on. I know we're, very close to making some hiring decisions related to the EMS director. Carl and I, have some meetings next week discussing that. And beginning to get a little bit further down the road of, how does our equipment acquisition plan work? How does our licensing application, what elements of that need to be filled out? That work is continuing to go on, behind the scenes. You're certainly not hearing a lot about our actions and efforts in that regard, but just wanted to report back to this board that I'm continuing to make sure that we're making advancement along the goal of setting that service in place October 1st, 2017. One way or the other, I want to not fall behind on that task, while we're in this period right now. So just wanted to give that update to you all. Okay. Other CMMC topics, here in just a minute, we'll hit the strategic planning marketing and I'll distribute some materials for your review.
Okay. Next item on the agenda is the Cobb Memorial Medical Center bylaws and board approval.
I can kind of share with you, Dr. Quinn is here. He was the lead of the physician bylaw committee review. And Dr. Profena has done with the medical staff is go through a complete revision of the bylaws top to bottom. And he provided for the board's review a two-column comparison of where we were and where we are now. Dr. Quinn, I'd love for you to make some comments and go from there.
Sure. Mm-hmm. Thanks for allowing me to speak here. Thanks for supporting updating the bylaws. As you can see by what it says on the old side versus the new side, we've done a complete revision. We had a committee of six docs, myself, Dr. Santiago, who's a hospitalist here, Dr. Golden from radiology, who's really a wealth of information about bylaws. He's been on several committees writing bylaws. Dr. Majors, who's an anesthesiologist here. Then Dr. Castillo, who's a family practitioner, and she's at Partners in Primary Care across the street. And she's very active on the staff with us. And then also Dr. Rayford Mitchell. He's down in Carnes City. He's a family practitioner. And so that group met with telephonically, mostly with Mary Bearden, who's a lawyer who has written over 200 sets of bylaws with her company. And as we went over the first bylaws, we found that they were kind of discordant. They were not consistent with Texas law. They were not consistent with federal law. They were not consistent with the goal of one day possibly being accredited by the Joint Commission. And so rather than rewrite those bylaws, we started with a new set. The new set was provided by Mary. Like I said, she's done over 200. And she bought a set, she brought a set that had already been approved at another hospital and brought it to us. It was at a larger hospital, so then we basically went page by page over the course of a year, essentially, going through everything and changing things as we see fit. you know, there's a lot of changes on there. I don't necessarily want to go over all those, but one of the things, you know, we talk at Conley about the quality of the physicians that we have here. I'm really lucky to work down here with this group of physicians. I really feel they're if they're not elite, they're pretty darn close to an elite group of physicians, and they're all very pro Conley, and so we, before there was no board certification required for physicians to work at Conley. We've updated that now, that there is a board certification at some time in your career to have. Most of us go through board certification when we come out of residency. We take a test at some point. There's a number of years you get to take that test, 3 to 6 years, to get board certified. And then we recertify every 10 years or so. Okay. That recertification process currently is really, I don't know if you've heard in the news, it is up in the air currently, because basically all the boards had gotten to the point where they were requiring way too much time and way too much money to get us recertified. And it didn't feel, we didn't feel as physicians that it was worth it. So currently we're not requiring that people get recertified, but they do have to be board certified at one time. We work with these people every day. We work with all the physicians that work here. We can tell whether they're competent one way or the other. One of the other things that is included in here related to that is focused professional evaluations and ongoing professional evaluation. So each of our department heads will develop a set of criteria and go over a certain number of cases over the course of a year to make sure over the course of 2 years, as people are credentialed every 2 years, to update that and make sure that our physicians are on top of their game going forward. There's also a lot of changes in hearings and how we report people to the National Practitioner Database if a mistake is made at some point. None of those things in the old bylaws were actually according to law or according to the Joint Commission. And now, currently, these are all up to date with those standards. I think, does anybody have any other questions on what was updated?
I'm just curious. I know you had 18 committees before, you're down to 5.
Yeah.
What are the 5? Just
well, the 5, the MEC is the big one. Then we have, I can't remember off the top of my head, you put me on the spot. One is credentialing. You have to have a separate credentialing. One is a patient safety. One is an improvement committee. And I can't remember the other one.
It's the energy department.
Yeah. A problem. I didn't want to abolish that one.
Yeah.
The problem with having 18 committees is essentially those 18 committees all require a physician on their committee. And we just got up to 18 providers. So we don't have 18, and so basically, if we had to have all, and those committee meetings were simply not occurring, you know, they were all being done sometimes. So by having the medical executive committee go over all the major committees and we'll report to the medical executive committee, that saves up a lot of people's time, and basically, you know, we have 5 to 6 doctors at any one time who are actively engaged in kind of all the committee structure, and it tends to be the same type of people who want to do that kind of stuff. And then we grow new ones going forward to get onto those committees. And so having, it's the same 5 people that would just take up more time rather than doing it all in one place. So we do it on a medical executive committee, and that takes care of all the requirements. And this is done in other hospitals that are small also. So that's why we cut it down. 18 to 5. Any other questions?
The committee did great work. I mean, you worked on this for 9 months.
Yeah, long time.
I love to put people on the spot.
I could find the ones.
Don't understand that.
You've been here, what, 4 years now?
No, well, I was here in 2013, so 3 years.
3 years.
Yes, August 20.
And it's great to see a doctor here.
Uh-huh.
And
these meetings. Can you give us just your background and what you have seen in the 3 years that you've been here?
Sure. You know, I was in the military. I retired in August of 2013. I was a flight surgeon, a hyperbaric physician, an internal medicine physician, and a preventive medicine physician. So I went through all these residencies, and one of the great things about the military is that you can change your profession. So I get bored easily. So I changed my profession on a regular basis. In the past 3 years here, you know, when I came, you know, I started probably for the first 6 months, seeing maybe over the course of a week, 20 patients, you know, and not having a lot of referrals, doing a lot of things, learning about civilian medicine, basically, because I didn't know anything about civilian medicine, billing, coding, all that kind of stuff. We really don't have to do that in the military. So learning all that, and you know, over the course of time, as we've grown to this big clinic system, you know, I've seen us get a lot more business, working with other subspecialists. I, you know, especially the addition of Preston Moorhead for me specifically. He's just a great guy to work with on a regular basis. We basically talk every day about patients. And one of the things that I can do here that I could do in the military too is I can call him and say, hey, why don't you come over and take a look at this? Patient doesn't have to move, doesn't have to be a new appointment. He can come into my clinic and see the patient. And we all have the luxury of having enough time and enough proximity to be able to do that. This week I also went over to see Dr. Nyack. I brought him the EKG, cleared this guy. Guy was cleared, you know. Patient didn't have to make appointments, anything like that. So there's been great growth here. The more specialists we're able to get and the more primary care docs that we're able to get will make the whole system stronger. And I think there's a big benefit of us all working in one place because we all use the same medical record and we can all refer to each other and we see exactly what we're all doing. So it's a great place to work. I really like it. I know all the docs. I've met with the docs on a regular basis, and they all love to work here. So
I know when we had a town hall meeting a couple of years ago, you mentioned that what you liked about being here was that you could practice medicine. You didn't,
right.
You didn't have staff to deal with, billing to deal with, accounts receivable. Is that still the case?
That's still the case. I mean, I think all of us, you know, a lot of what attracts doctors to come down here, first of all, I mean, we've had a lot of doctors, well, three doctors leave a private practice to come down here and work because it's such a pain in the neck on the outside, and with all the necessary technology that we need now to do our EMRs, our electronic medical records, and do reporting and do quality, you really need a big brother to kind of help you. And so being on kind of a team where that's provided for you and then not having to deal with staffing and not having to deal with billing is just a big deal for a physician because most of us just want to see patients, right? And want to do our craft on a daily basis. So it really helps a lot. And I think to a man or woman here on staff, I would say the same thing. Anything else?
Anyone else have a question?
All right. Thanks.
Thank you. We need a motion. Yeah, we'll need a motion to approve the bylaw changes.
I move.
Are you a second?
Second.
Moved by Tom Miller, seconded by Marcelo Lejos, that we accept the bylaw changes as presented. All in favor, raise your hand. All opposed? Motion carries. Next item is strategic planning and marketing committee report.
Well, we have a meeting scheduled for next Tuesday night, January 24th, at 6 p.m.
Correct.
And we have not had a meeting since our last board meeting, so we don't have anything to report about any other meetings. If all of you could be here for the meeting next Tuesday night, it would be much appreciated.
That'll be at 6 o'clock?
6 o'clock, yes, sir.
Okay. Yeah.
And I have some materials
to distribute.
You do have some for current?
To distribute.
Yeah, and this is for preparation for that Tuesday night meeting.
That's correct. So I'm just going to hand this out just simply for you to have, to know what it is, and then you can certainly study it at your leisure, and these will be some of the topics that we cover. I didn't exactly know the best way to frame some of the conversations. I did one of my old school CEO update reports. This is, some of you have probably seen this before, but it covers a couple of different areas. Number one, I wanted to address the question, where are we on our Vision 2020 plan? This slide kind of illustrates where we are with what we said we were going to do and where we are in our time frame. And I think you'll be very pleased with that portion of the report. There's a discussion about the medical office building. There's a brief little simple financial arrangements there related to the medical office building. You'll see some items on that. Then there's a description of Crimson Market Advantage. Crimson Market Advantage is that market research database that we have access to. So I've printed for you a number of slides that have been prepared for me about our markets from a specialty standpoint and from a physician standpoint. So I think you'll find that very interesting to review and look at. And then finally, one of the last pieces of items that I want to distribute is simply kind of a marketing summary. We've been talking about marketing plans. The conversation's been around for quite some time. Sam and the team did a great job of moving past the idea of a marketing plan and just addressing marketing actions. What is happening? What actions are we going to be taking? So what you'll see here is a few pages. Number one, the direct marketing actions, one-to-one marketing over the course of the next several months, and then really month by month, January, February, March, April, May, all the way through June, of other types of marketing actions that are going to be taking place. So in some respects, of course, it is a marketing plan, but I'm wanting to really shift the words away from, hey, we're trying to plan what we're going to do, into simply, these are the actions that we know we're going to be taking, so I wanted to make you aware of those items. Okay? So let me hand those out for you. I would encourage you to, not necessarily tonight, but to review them. And I think that will help us have a very productive conversation. The other item, just so you know, that will be making its way around, this is the actual Vision 2020 plan. You will remember that this was our effort to look at the market demand, to then determine our physician needs during that time, determine our facility needs during that time, and then figure out how to pay for all that. So I wanted to share this again with you as it related to my CEO report so that you could re-refresh yourself of where we are on those items. Okay?
Homework.
So those are some items for
everybody, please review this before the meeting next Tuesday so we'll kind of be up to speed on everything and we can really get some things accomplished at that point.
Yeah, if anyone wanted to shoot me any questions or anything ahead of time too, that would be awesome, but not necessary. Yeah.
Can one of the doctors be here?
I speculate the answer is yes.
Definitely.
Since the draft says to recruit and retain primary care and specialist providers, you're good to have somebody, a doctor here, to give us their feedback on how we can best accomplish that. What y'all think?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Surely one of the five that do all this will be here.
Hi, two of us.
Thank you.
Okay. Next item on our agenda is the special rollback tax election. Number A, review, consider, take action on the first amended election board.
Loretta is leading this effort, so I'm going to have her speak to these items.
Okay, it's just not me. It's also Shirley, who has done it in the past, so I'll ask her to come up here with me. What we have already posted legally, what we have to have posted, which we did January 4th, was the first order of election. And this is already posted out on our website, as well as on our bulletin board, as well as at the courthouse, so forth and so on. This amended copy, however, we did have a correction on Election Day voting. We did have from 8 to 5, it's actually 7 to 7.
Thank
so
you.
We had to get that changed.
Okay.
So I'm going to look to you, Larry, because I've got to have your signature. You've done this one before, so this is the amendment. This we're doing it again. Yes. And then, of course, I'll make your signature.
That's one thing. I
and we also have it in Spanish, too, as well, which is required.
Yeah.
Don't forget to do the second page in Spanish. Thank you very much.
Make sure
I can't spell my name.
The second thing that everybody has a copy of that's going to require, again, Larry and Tom, your signature, is an order of the Wilson County Memorial Hospital District adopting voting precinct grant boundaries, appointing an election agent, appointing election judges, setting compensation for those election judges and clerks, and providing for the types of ballots that we will use, and taking other actions related to the March 11, 2017 special election. And then it just goes on. Do you want me to read it? If we
you
can just take a minute just to read.
Really
okay. Yes. When we get to page 2, I do want to point out some Election Day polling locations.